It's so good to be with you again on Answers for Today as we're doing our prophecy update series right now. We really enjoy spending time with you, talking about the events that we believe are going to be taking place in our near future. But today, again, we want to be setting the stage, looking back in order that we might look forward. I believe that we're living in very exciting days. As if you were in a backstage. Have you ever been in a high school play or any play when you're in the backstage feeling the drama, the excitement before the curtain would rise up for the final act? The director, of course, would be positioning everybody. Everything's coming together and they're about ready to pull that curtain up for that final act. Of course, the analogy with that is I believe that right before our eyes, God is positioning the nations for the current with the current events for the final act that's going to be happening right before our eyes. God is the one that's orchestrating this. God's the one that's laying everything out, how they've been prophesied in the Old Testament and with the New Testament concerning the return of Jesus Christ. Maybe you played that game Dominoes as a kid, or maybe you're still playing it as an adult. You remember you could take dominoes, which is very interesting. I'll put a picture up there in case you don't know the game I'm talking about, where you could line one domino up and then you line another one and so on until you get this whole row of dominoes up. And once you get that long line in sequence, all you have to do is touch one of them, and then the rest of them start following and tumbling down after that. Well, I believe that God is aligning the world situation, as much as he would line up dominoes. He's getting ready to tip the first event that will cause this second one, and then also ultimately the third one, and fourth, and so on, until they just all fall into place. But before we look at these events, before we looked at these Bible prophecies, let me emphasize one thing to you. I have no intention in telling you the day and in the hour and the moment that Jesus Christ is coming back. In fact, in Matthew chapter 24, verse 16, it tells us that no one knows the day or the hour. Or so if somebody is out there trying to tell you, say, I know exactly when Jesus Christ is coming back, I would encourage you not to pay attention to that, because Jesus tells us right there in Matthew 24, verse 36. But the Bible does tell us, and Paul in writing in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, beginning in verse number 1, he writes, "Of the time and season, brethren, you have no need that I write unto you, for you yourself know perfectly that the day of the Lord shall come as a thief in the night. But ye, brethren, are not in darkness, that the day should overtake you as a thief." So God wants us to be expecting, looking for his return. And to this end, he gives us many signs to let us know and recognize the time of his promise of when he's coming back. And so that's what we want to do. We want to look back in order that we might look forward to the return of Jesus Christ. What I'd like us to do today is we'll look briefly at an amazing prophecy from the Old Testament. Of course, it's a very familiar book to many of you, and to some of you who are watching this, maybe not so. It's the book of Daniel. You know, there are so many Bible scoffers that really don't like the book of Daniel because of the accuracy of the script of the prophecies that are laid out in the book of Daniel. They like to think that Daniel couldn't have written that, but yet he did, because they not only came true, but the future prophecies are starting to come true right before us. Daniel is one of the most fascinating books of prophecies in the Bible. In chapter 1, when you open it up, remember, Daniel was born there in Israel. He was a young Hebrew. He was captured by King Nebuchadnezzar when they came and conquered Israel by the Babylonians. When the Babylonian army came in, Nebuchadnezzar was the king at that time, and he was captured. And his prophecy gives us keen insight to the events that leads to Christ's return, the prophecies of Daniel. And so we get this picture of Daniel. Some people think that he's 15 years old, and some say as old as 19, being led away from Israel to this great country, this huge country known as Babylon. And of course, what they would do is they would conquer a nation, they would take the youngest, choice people, the ones that had most potential, and they would bring them and train them up in their court in order that they might become part of their, government per se, where they could use their skills, the things that they see in them in order to be able to help run their nation. And so that's what Daniel did in chapter 1. We see how he was in that court learning the ways of the Babylonians and the Chaldeans. He tells us as he opens up, though, in chapter 2, and that's what I'd like you to look at here today, is chapter 2. He says, "One night Nebuchadnezzar, King Nebuchadnezzar, had a nightmare that greatly troubled him." Have you ever had a nightmare? I hope you're not having one, this evening after we look at this, but he had a terrible nightmare. And he woke, the story tells us, he woke terrified by the dream, but he wasn't able to remember the details. He wasn't able to remember the dreams. It left him only lingering with that effect of being horrified by what the dream was all about. And so Nebuchadnezzar, he had that dream, and so he called all the so-called wise men of the land, all over the powerful nation of Babylon. He called for all the wise men to come, all the soothsayers, everybody that was supposed to have the ability to be able to interpret dreams. And he asked them all to think about what this dream meant and to give them the interpretation. Nebuchadnezzar told them that he wasn't able to recount the dream. He wasn't able to even describe it to them. But he says, if you guys didn't give me the interpretation, your head's going to be on the chopping block. Can you imagine these guys kind of panicking and say, well, we can't even give them any type of interpretation because we don't know what the dream even was. So Nebuchadnezzar reasoned with them, and they could not believe certainly this unreasonable demand of the king. And so we have all of a sudden, once again, we're introduced to Daniel. In chapter 1, Daniel had an overseer as he was preparing himself for the court of the king. His name was Arioch. He was the captain over the king's guard, and he told young Daniel of the dangers he faced as a young man, a wise man, being trained up of what the king had called them to do. And Daniel had been groomed as a counselor. And so he too was to be executed. And so the captain, he told the king that that there is another fellow, Daniel. You should ask Daniel. You should give Daniel a opportunity. And so Arioch told them, Nebuchadnezzar, this of this young Hebrew, and they brought Daniel before the king. Meanwhile, Daniel had his friends next to him, so he asked all of his friends, he says, please pray that the God of heaven might reveal to me the king's dream unto me. And God was faithful. God was faithful to reveal the dream and the interpretations unto Daniel. It was quickly brought before Nebuchadnezzar. The king said that he heard that the young man could tell him the dream and the interpretation of the meeting. And it tells us here in chapter 2, Daniel answered. He says, no, but there is a God in heaven who knows all things. He says, Daniel wasn't taking credit for the opportunity that he had, that he was the one that could interpret the dream. He says, God's able to give me the answer. And he knows what you dreamed and what it means, and he has revealed it to me. Then he continued and said, tells us in chapter 2, he says, The other night, O King Nebuchadnezzar, as you were lying on your bed, you were thinking of the power and greatness of your Babylonian kingdom. Then the thought came into your mind, what shall come to pass in the future? What will happen to my kingdom? How I will know, or how will the world end? So God gave him a dream to reveal to him what will come to pass in these last days. Isn't it amazing? Here was this king Nebuchadnezzar, just laying there in bed, thinking like, what's going to happen to me? What's going to happen to me, my kingdom? What's the future going to be all about? Isn't it a lot of times, I think it's a very common question that most people have. I failed to mention about Nebuchadnezzar. He was known as the most powerful king that ever was. There wasn't a king like him before him or after him. In that, Nebuchadnezzar had what was known as autocratic rule. Otherwise, he had all power. What he said happened. And so here's this all-powerful king, not knowing what's going to happen to him in the future. So God gave him this dream. And it goes on, and he says, in your dream you saw a great image. It had a head of gold and a breast and arms of silver, stomach and thighs of brass, legs of iron, feet of iron, and clays with 10 toes. You watched the image until the stone not cut with hands hit the great image in the feet, and the whole image crumbled to the stone grew into the mountain and it filled the whole earth. Oh my goodness, what a wild dream that he was having at this point. And Nebuchadnezzar, as soon as he said these things, recalled the dream that Daniel had described to him. And he really pressed Daniel. He says, please give me the understanding. And Daniel explained, you, O king, are the head of gold. God has given you great and powerful kingdom, which extends throughout the civilized, or the real the world known at that time. A tremendous kingdom. And you can look, as I have a map up there for you to look at, the extent of the kingdom, how far reaching it was. After you, another kingdom shall rise that is inferior to you. He says there's going to be another kingdom that comes up. In fact, in Daniel chapter 8, verse 20, it tells that the kingdom is identified as the Medo-Persian Empire, which was under Cyrus the king. Indeed did conquer Babylon. However, as the interpretation continued, the kingdom will also be supplanted by a kingdom which is represented by the brass stomach. As you can see the picture that I have up there for you of this dream, now we're at the stomach area, the brass stomach, which is in Daniel chapter 8, verse 21, is identified as Greece. Isn't that interesting how that is identified as Greece? This fascinating prophecy, why so many skeptics have so much trouble with it, happened approximately 600 BC. Greece at that time, at best, was a small, unknown province in the western part of the world. It hasn't even begun to rise to power. Alexander the Great hasn't come into power yet, and it's still a ways down the road. But yet we see here, Daniel is speaking about a day which Greece is going to arise. And then the kingdom of Greece is going to be conquered by another kingdom, representing the iron legs. It's, as you take a look again at the statues of this dream that Daniel had, this picture of these iron legs, and historically, of course, it turned out to be the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire was as strong as iron. It broke it. It subdued the world with its iron fist. So far as these predictions, of course, have unfolded, it's really easy to look back at history to see how these all how happened, how they came, and the sequence of events are being laid out for us. We're left with a prediction, one more prediction that we see here in this picture of this statue, as it talks about the final world dominating kingdom, not yet exercising over the entire earth. We haven't seen it yet. But the picture it has here, of course, is a picture that's going to dominate the whole world. For the description that we have here that Daniel gives us is an empire that's part iron and part clay, insomuch that iron represents the Imperial Roman Empire. The final part will also be mixed with clay. That really shows us that clay being a weaker part of the iron. This could be significant in the weak attempt at reviving the Roman Empire. But as you look at this, that we're told that the 10 toes represent 10 kings that shall unite their power. 10 different kings coming together, unite their power. The prophecies could easily be embodied by the nations of Europe, known even today as the European Community, or used to be known as the European Economic Community, the EEC, all economic borders, which I find it's interesting, of the EEC or the European Community, were removed midnight in December 1992. And there was this merger that came together to form this amazing alliance there in Europe, where they at one time would become this tremendous world power. I'm going to show you a little video clip from our friend, our pastor, Pastor Chuck Smith. Of course, he's now moved on to heaven, and he's looking at things from a different perspective, from a heavenly perspective. But this video clip comes from 1979. As he talks about these events that we're talking about right here of the European Community and how he will lay out for us just what we're talking about. So take a look at this little short video clip.
While in Europe, one sees an interesting formation of 10 nations federating together to form the European Community, which is a fulfillment of biblical prophecy. It is incredible to realize that the building that I am sitting in front of has the potential of fulfilling a prophecy that was made over 2,500 years ago. This prophecy is recorded in the book of Daniel. We read that when Nebuchadnezzar was king of Babylon, the first major world-governing empire, that one night before he went to sleep, he was wondering, what is to come of the world? What will become of my empire? What will follow after me? And that night he had a very interesting dream. The dream troubled him extremely. When he woke up in the morning, he could not remember the dream, and he was curious as to its meaning. And so he gathered together his wise men and counselors, but they were not able to help him. Finally, Daniel was brought in. And Daniel said unto the king, God has shown to you the kingdoms of the world, those empires that will govern this world. In your dream, you saw a great image. It had a head of gold. It had shoulders of silver. It had a stomach of brass and feet of iron and clay. Daniel said, Nebuchadnezzar, you are the head of gold, but your empire is to be replaced by the Medo-Persian Empire, the shoulders of silver. That empire, in turn, will be replaced by the Grecian Empire, the stomach of brass. That, in turn, by the Roman Empire, the legs of iron. The final world-governing empire will be a federation of European nations that are related to the Roman Empire, but they will be joined together in a democratic union. In the European Community, we find the potential for the final world-governing empire.
That was exciting to take a look at that. It's exciting aspect of the whole Bible prophecy the Bible believers has found in Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. You know, the thing that's interesting is, remember, we haven't seen this whole picture that of this dream that Nebuchadnezzar had. We've seen the different parts of the really the powers that come into being from the gold head all the way down through the breastplate, all the way down to the toes themselves. But the thing that is exciting in Daniel chapter 2, verse 47, he also acknowledged there was a God in the world like the God of Daniel. Nebuchadnezzar, after seeing this dream, he says, there's nobody like you. There's nobody other God like you. And right before that, we had in verse 44, we're told of that during this day, the days, during what days? During the days of the ten toes, or these ten kings coming together. It speaks about the rock cut without human hands. And I believe that is Jesus Christ. And it speaks about how he's going to come again and establish himself as God's everlasting kingdom. What a day for us to rejoice. Later, as we move on, Nebuchadnezzar defiled the revelation of God. God had given him this tremendous revelation, and he had just said, there is no other God like the God of Daniel in Daniel chapter 2, verse 47. And in fact, he got so upset and I think so troubled by what he knew that he decided to build a great image. He built this great image. It tells us in Daniel, he says it was 90 feet tall. And he made of entirely of gold to be erected in the plain of Duran. Duran, as you would head out of the capital, it's about, you know, where you could see so far out. It's a really flat plain where you could see this 90-foot tower being raised up, this beautiful gold shining and shimmering, so you could see it so far away. By making it all gold, what do you think that was referred to? Remember the head of gold? Being Nebuchadnezzar was declaring that no one could conquer his kingdom. And the Babylonian kingdom that he said set up would stand forever. He didn't want to submit to what Daniel's dream had to say. The king, of course, ordered all the people to bow down before him. And at any time that they would hear a trumpet sound, any place in the kingdom, you were to bow down and worship that image that was put up. And if you found that you did do that, of course, there was going to be consequences to pay. And there was the story of these three young Hebrew men. They were friends of Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And of course, there came time where they were supposed to bow down to this image, and they did not. And so the story tells us that when word came back to Nebuchadnezzar about these guys, he was so irate, and they were supposedly cast into the burning furnace, into the burning fire, that they would heat so hot that anybody would come close to them, they would be burnt, they would be wiped out. They're in the flames, as we see, as they're thrown into this burning furnace. It tells us a fourth man with the likeness of the Son of God joined them and protected them from the being harmed by the fire in Daniel chapter 3, verse 25 and verse 27. The question arises, where was Daniel at this time? Why was he with his close buddies? Why wasn't he there? Well, we must assume that he was either down in other part of the country, as God had risen him up to a place of prominence there with the government, taking care of business. I think it's interesting that God delivered them out of this field. But the sad story of Nebuchadnezzar, as you start reading through the story, you almost get to like, man, I really like this guy. You know, what he had gone through. But as he rejected God's revelation to them, like I said earlier, there was consequences to pay. As we look back, we could certainly examine other men's failures, and we can look to our own lives as we look forward to examine ourselves. Are we one that are caught up with pride, where we say, we don't need God, I don't want to believe God's word? See, the prophecies that Daniel had given, the interpretation of the dream came true, 100% true. The question is, will you choose to believe it or not? The story goes that Nebuchadnezzar went insane as you read farther along in the story. And he left out, he was moved out of the kingdom, and he ate grass like a wild oxen would. His hair grew long and was covered his body like feathers, and his nails became like claws. A terrible place where you might think of it. And he was left there for 7 seasons, it tells us. And then after this 7th season, it tells us that his senses came back to them. Regardless how long the insanity was that he had to face, he remained in this condition long enough that God in heaven lift up and established kings, and he pulls down who he chooses. Nebuchadnezzar was able to say that and was able to realize, he says, God sets up on the throne, the real throne, and he rises up kings and he pulls them down. Then the king again acknowledges the power of God and in God's power until the end of life there in Daniel chapter 4, verse 37. What do I mean by all this? It means that God's in control. We serve a sovereign God. The prophecies of yesterday are the prophecy of today. As we look back and we see these fascinating things that happened so many years ago, but yet even at looking at those and we see them how they come to be true, we also see how our future prophecies, how they're right at the corner, ready to happen. As I said earlier, it's like God has lined up the dominoes, the events that are about ready to happen, and they're about ready to topple over. As we see the prophecies of old coming true today. Next time that we're together, we're going to continue in the book of Daniel. We'll be talking about that world leader that's going to come in to be. He's known as the Antichrist, and he's about ready to come on stage to set up his kingdom. You know, what should we be doing when we look at these verses, when we look at these events? Jesus tells us in Matthew chapter 24, and as you look at Matthew chapter 25, he gives us a very strong exhortation. In fact, he tells us that we should watch, and what else? And be ready. So the key thing is that, as I said earlier, that we should be having our eyes looking up for the return of Jesus Christ, with one eye looking for his return, and the other eye looking around how God might use us in this world this day. There is a work to be done. There's a work to be spreading the gospel. And I pray that you might be about doing that. And if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, I would ask you that you would take time to examine the evidence, the prophecies that are in the Old Testament and in the New Testament concerning Jesus Christ. They cannot be denied. That you would take time to examine the truth that we find in God's Word. And so, until next time, this is Pastor Terry, in behalf of the team here at Answers for Today, may God richly bless you.
For information about this broadcast, or if you have any questions, feel free to mail us at Agape Chapel OC, P.O. Box 4023, Huntington Beach, California, 92647. Or you can email us at aft@agapechapeloc.org. Or visit our website at agapechapeloc.org. Until next time.